And welcome to the first edition of the podcast for science fiction films that are coming out now, and maybe even books. This is Kaya here with me. Kaya, say hello.
Hello.
So, yeah, there's been so much going on over the past several years with Star Wars. Star Wars has really been, I guess, one of the big subjects going on now. I myself am, like so many of you, one of the billions of fans, just one in a billion, just one drop of water in an ocean of fans of Star Wars. The fan base has become, the fan base kind of broke off into two or three, four, five, six, seven sections. Because of The Last Jedi, and mainly what happened with Luke. All the other stuff is okay. Last Jedi was a beautifully filmed movie, just very elegant, very cinematic. And I guess one of the parts I really did like in the movie was the, it was kind of hard to believe that Snoke, who had been delivered so powerful, much in the fashion as the Emperor. And then if you read the books, so like Darth Plagueis, he's the one that trained Emperor Palpatine, Darth Sidious, to rule over the galaxy as an emperor. And so Snoke, you know, you would expect somewhat more powerful, because this is what is known of him, that he was from the unknown regions. And I guess the delight to Sith and Sith-like beings. And very, very, very powerful, but was killed so easily. But what we did get to see is Rey and Kylo Ren, and that was kind of stunning. That just absolutely amazing, the sequence of Rey and Kylo Ren joining together against the Praetorian guards when Snoke was struck down, and then Rey's gesture that saved his life, tossing him the lightsaber. And then what he said, though, was just very, very powerful. He was saying that, you know, just come away with me. We'll leave all of this behind. No more Jedi, no more Sith. And I buy into that. I mean, that's what was going on with Luke. He was just down on the idea of not... He wasn't down on the idea. That's not really the way of saying it. He had just become very critical, I guess, of the idea of the Sith. The Sith being the polar opposite... I'm not the Sith, but the Jedi being the polar opposite of the Sith, and possibly the reason for all the conflict is because you have one, there's one side and then there's another side, but there is this gray area, you know, the gray, not even Jedi, the gray force user, I guess. Did you hear any of that, Kaya?
Yeah, all of it.
What'd you think of Kylo Ren?
I really honestly have no idea. I'm not a Star Wars fan here.
But we're running this whole podcast based on, he's the guy in black with a helmet that was kind of like Darth Vader, but perhaps not as awesome as Darth Vader. Now, do you know who I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know who you're talking about, but...
What about Rey? What are you laughing at?
I don't know.
You laughing at Rey? Oh my, oh my, oh my god. Oh my gosh. All the people out there are just going to be so, they don't know. They don't know, do you like Rey or not like Rey? I like Rey. Rey's a good idea. Rey is the, obviously the Luke Skywalker of this saga. And she's awesome. She's cool. And I think people got kind of sidestepped by The Last Jedi's treatment of Luke, and some of that criticism began to reflect on Rey. And I don't think so. I loved The Force Awakens. That was just an excellent film. And I don't think that it was a rehash of Star Wars: A New Hope any more than I think that all vampire movies are somehow a rehash of each other. They're not. It's a genre, really. I mean, a lot of the fans, the people are kind of young, and so they're not familiar with Joseph Campbell's ideas of the hero and the hero's journey and the archetype. That's what we saw in The Force Awakens, was the that heroic archetype being recreated. And sure, you can match ideas and scenes, but there's really only so much you're going to be able to do in space when it comes to a space opera, such as Star Wars. But I honestly didn't find it anything like A New Hope, considering that the rules were reversed. She's the hero, the heroic character on the journey in these films. But the idea of them coming together, that's unique. We didn't see Darth Vader, you know, suddenly looking into each other's eyes with puppy love and saying, let's run away. The closest we got to that was Darth Vader saying, come with me, Luke, and we will rule the galaxy together. But thank goodness, you know, we didn't see puppy love or anything between Luke and his father. But what we see with Rey is we see puppy love, or a willingness to find some kind of a common ground. And that was probably one of the, I'd say that was the only really big achievement. That was the only achievement in a film that largely destroyed so much of what had been set up in The Force Awakens. So that is interesting, and so it'll be interesting to see what happens in the next film. But I don't know. I don't think fans are sitting on the edge of their seats for this film. I think there's just so much doubt as to what's going to happen. Mainly, we can go back to the very beginning, and this film was supposed to be about Leia, Luke, and Han, and any other characters were side characters. But the whole thing was derailed because of the controversy of The Last Jedi. I mean, it just soured Lucasfilm, I think, and Disney altogether. We'll just say Disney just soured. Star Wars was very soured on them, and so it's doubtful that we will ever see a story that that returns to Rey and them. And kind of, you know, personally, in a way, I hope there isn't a story. I mean, it'd be neat to see them maybe in a film or what's going on with them, but please, they cannot meet no other, you know, no great, at least no great Sith force or power. It's got to be something different. I mean, if many years down the line they decide to revisit them. Because for goodness sake, it's over. It should be over. I hope they clear this whole thing up. I hope that we are left with the impression that it's done, that good, or mostly good, has won over the galaxy, and that maybe Coruscant's still out there, and so there's been re-establishment of the core center of the Republic. And hopefully we also see that the Jedi are no longer Jedi, perhaps, and they've in an interest of curbing the interest in there being Sith. For as long as there are Sith, there will be Jedi. As long as there are Jedi, there will be Sith. I'm waiting for Kaya to say something.
I don't know. They say that The Rise of Skywalker is going to be the last movie in the saga, but I bet they said that back in, I think, the 1980s with, I think, that other Star Wars film.
Return of the Jedi.
Yeah, I bet they said, like, that.
Or...
So we can only wonder what will happen in the next 30 years after the release of the movie.
Well, Return of the Jedi was basically an end to it all. I mean, it was an end to it all. But I think the controversy over the years is what happens when you know, looking at the physics of the size of a Death Star and falling towards the center of it, and how long that would actually take to fall through the center, and how fast he'd be going, and then the doubt, you know, that not being in it, you know, that I know it's not been mentioned in any of the canon books that lead up to Rise of the Skywalker. So, but you hear the Emperor's laugh, but I, you know, we all would just love to see some new incarnation, or that the Emperor, or that the Emperor survived. But how can that be? Luke didn't. That was one of the darkest aspects of... No, it was the darkest aspect of The Last Jedi, was killing Luke off. But mainly how they... just treating him so horribly. The character so terribly. The character being so uncharacteristic of what we know of Luke Skywalker. Of what we've seen of Luke Skywalker. He's really the central figure. It's, you know, George Lucas said it was Anakin. But the only character that has been present throughout all of the films, with the exception of the first two, is Luke Skywalker. But his presence, and for all I know, it's just going to be a cameo presence. I mean, Mark Hamill hints at that, just a cameo presence, you know, cameo, like it's already terrible. He's just a force ghost and everything. Well, you know, like Yoda did in The Last Jedi, he's going to be able to use force powers. No, it's not the same as the character being present. And then again, we go back to that this was supposed to be about the last send off for those characters. It was supposed to be about those characters, the main stories. And then the new players were, you know, to be on the side. That's how you finish off a saga. You finish off with the people that you're dealing with. And of course, yes, you have characters like Rey and all that, but that's the movie had, the saga had room for Luke, Han, and Leia. And I think some of the problem is that they really, and this has already been discussed over and over and up and down, that they let Harrison Ford have too much control over the film by saying, kill me off, you know. Just over the years, I tell you, as a person that started with Star Wars from the very beginning, before it was A New Hope, it was just Star Wars, possibly a standalone film, and they were not sure what was going to happen, that there was going to be any more. And that movie pretty much by itself summed it all up, you know, just one film. Because they destroyed the Death Star, they beat back evil, and that could have been the end. But no, Darth Vader got away in his personal TIE fighter. I wonder how many people out there know what a TIE fighter actually is. What does it mean? What does it stand for? How are you on your mythology in Star Wars? Put down the comments below if you know. And don't copy what others, you know, somebody's going to get it right, hopefully pretty quickly. I'll go ahead and tell you now, though. I'll let you write it down, and then you can see it. Go ahead, write it down. Don't wait for me to tell you. Okay, so you've written it down. You've written down your comment. TIE fighters were about dudes in suits, because that was deemed as one of the big problems in the 70s. Dudes in suits going about business, the bureaucracy of everything, of war, of what happened in Vietnam. And the lack of control that the in a democracy, that the democratic constituency, which is the public, the say that they had. Most people were against it. They were saying, okay, we don't like this war, so pull back. It's not doing anyone any good. Just pull back. And you know, Vietnam was so far away, but anyway. And so they really, you know, they didn't listen to the people. And so there were protests like never before in the United States, so much protest, without social media protest. And so Star Wars was about that. Star Wars was about this, the idea of all these people, these dudes in suits that were running everything in front of the scenes, but mostly behind the scenes, and military-industrial complex and all of that, that was behind the scenes. And so a TIE was the TIE that was worn by the bureaucracy, and so a TIE fighter. And the X-Wings fought against the TIEs. What I don't like is that they were, you know, back then, I understand, I guess now, but, you know, the X-Wings would have been better as with blue stripes instead of red stripes. Some of the effects I've done on this channel of X-Wings, I've always changed the color to blue. What were you laughing about? What do you think? I know what you're thinking. You're thinking about how did Vader successfully navigate the toiletry.
No. Although you might make my mind wander to that or something. But okay, if I can get my mind back on it. I was picturing like a bunch of these floating bow ties and such in space being shot by lasers and such.
Yeah. Well, the bow ties would be the bow ties of the gluttonously rich, that for them it was like a sport, like being at the racetracks, watching the galaxy undo itself. But yeah, that's exactly where the war should have been taken to, shouldn't it? By the rebels. Because that's where the real power was. That's where the generation of vessels of war of the, whether it be the Empire or the First Order, that's where it all starts. And so you go to these people and you say, you go after them. At least in the Star Wars universe, you go after them. It's not like in our universe where in our world, where so many of the people that are wealthy, you know, now say, hey, you know, tax us. I don't know about the others that are and what they're. I know it's a very dark picture. So the film, you know, it resonates, you know, in that regard. It resonates with modern times still. There's always a drumbeat of some kind of a conflict. And there's this conflict with this, well, I'm making air quotes now, with Putin and the United States. But it seems more to me that if Putin acts like the menace or a phantom menace, then it he becomes the causation of a resurgence in the arms sale industry. When there's so much better that can be done, you know, an age of exploration. I mean, NASA's budget is just so down. Space is the place.
Space is the place.
And when I was a kid, just on a whole kind of a different track here. I mean, when I was a kid, we watched Star Wars. There was a perception of what the future was going to look like, at least by the year 2000. But none of that could have come true because of the military-industrial complex. Everybody said, everybody in their the suit, the bureaucracy said, well, you know, it's going to be a trickle up thing because the research in new weaponry actually creates technologies that benefit people. Well. How about reverse? Well, I don't know about reversing that. How about you just focus all your research on curing disease, and you know, creating. I don't know about longevity. It's hard to talk about longevity. That's a technology perhaps not to be worked on. You know, where people are like, well, I want to live for 300 years. What's wrong with you? Why would you want to live on this world for 300? It's miserable sometimes now. And even if you're rich, you get bored. Would you want to be, I mean, if it was just terrible? I mean, you get up to a certain age, and it's like, I'm sick of this, you know. And that's why people get up to a certain age, and then they begin to see the end of life is not a terrible thing, because, you know, it's terrible that, you know, they'll miss their loved ones. But it's like, oh, I've done my tenor on this world. So, you know, that's one technology not to work on. What should be worked on is making sure you are as active and comfortable until the day you drop dead. And technologies of equality. But that's the bureaucracy, and how will that be manifest in Star Wars? I can tell you they're not doing it seamlessly. They're not doing equality seamlessly. They're not doing the right things seamlessly. And what I mean by that is that, Princess Leia was a badass already in Star Wars, A New Hope, and then in the films after that. She wasn't like standing on a podium, you know, while there was blaster fire going around and say, I'm as a woman, I'm going to stand up here and I'm going to do whatever it is. None of this was going on. And it kind of goes back to a story, actually. A story that's relates to Star Wars, but it's in the real world. When I was a kid, in the 80s, I was a kid. There were, you know, way back, there was a... At the beginning of the 80s, there was a couple. I just don't remember their names, and if I did, I wouldn't give them to you. But it was this African American guy at the school, an athlete, popular, loved, absolute athlete, and his girlfriend, your typical blonde, your white girl, and nobody blinked an eye. Nobody had anything to say about that, and they were prom king and queen. And when it comes to people being gay or not, well, people that were gay were not openly, you know, they were afraid to tell people at that time. But as in the early 80s, and as the 80s moved on, people were just out of the closet. And that was kind of a big deal going on, is that it was, you know, we had the era of Karma Chameleon and all the karma chameleon culture club and the music. That maybe that's one of the things, you know, about the 80s music that people really latch onto, is that it the songs were about how it really was. You know, they were not there was nobody saying that, you know, calling foul on the music, and so we already had that open culture. And then suddenly by the late 90s something happened. And in my hometown, suddenly, you know, that never had a problem with the couple that I just previously told you about. Well, suddenly it was a big controversy that there was going to be an African-American prom king and then a white prom queen. And they didn't want them to be together in the parade and all this other stuff. And I was like, where did this come from? Because that's not the way the city used to be. City also used to be populated by 36,000 people. It was a middle-sized city, and it was big. Now it's down to 12,000, a third of which are criminals. Isn't that what's going on? A third of which are criminals. We've had them living on both sides of us. You know, waving guns around, and the police are always, oh.
Raping guns.
We're doing an investigation, you know, and they're out there smoking. Yeah, you don't know what they're smoking and all that. So, but Star Wars, you know, was always for people that are living in conditions of strife and stress. You know, it was always a release. It was an escape. And I can say one thing about that: it's not quite been the escape that it was supposed to be, because they bandstand the equality. Where in the 70s and the 80s, the equality of expression, it just happened. And so it's like, it seems like young people think like this is a brand new thing, and it's not. It's probably been dampened, and so there's the necessity of a resurgence of understanding. But even during the time of Martin Luther King, when we were all, well, most of us were coming together and saying, you know, this idea of perceiving people by their race or their creed as an identifying factor as to their character was going away. And on television, some of the earliest television reflected this desire for change, with TV shows, you know, sitcoms. And one of the earliest ones, and this is science fiction, one of the earliest science fiction programs that dealt with, they didn't bandstand about their equality, just suddenly on the show, it was just The Outer Limits, the black and white version of The Outer Limits from the 50s. And we're talking from the 50s! Okay, we're talking about from the racist 50s. It's like, if you wanted to enjoy Outer Limits, you wanted to enjoy that science fiction, then you enjoyed what was going on with that science fiction. Now, I never really got to see the show until later years when the series, you know, appeared on streaming services and stuff. And so Yeah, I've been watching that off and on Hulu for, the past 3 years. And I was just absolutely captivated by there being, usually often in the show there's a command structure, a military command structure that deals with some kind of an issue. And there's a lot of episodes have something to do with military or futuristic military or a military that has a space presence of some kind. And so you see African American people, men, being the highest ranking people with their underlings being white people that follow their orders right away. And you see that you saw this in Outer Limits when nobody was asking them to do that. It was a natural expression of what was right. And that is seamless. That's what you call seamless equality. And all throughout the 70s, you began to see this seamless kind of equality that was just coming out in theaters. And best represented in Star Wars, which later became A New Hope, where Leia was seamlessly very tough. And we've seen characters like her before in other shows that were not in the science fiction genre. But now, everybody wants to point it out. Everybody, it's kind of like being in church, right? Is that what a lot of the programming today says to me? It's much like, and I don't believe in the stuff that I used to now. But when I was a kid, I had to go to the Catholic church. We had to go to services. And one thing you didn't do is that you didn't. The idea was you tithed, you put money into the pot that was passed around, on to I guess enrich the Vatican so they could buy more gold. I'm just kidding, but more gold
That
so they
or
could collect more gold.
that or
The real leprechauns.
no wait, collect all that gold and make a giant golden statue of some god or something.
No, but I mean, you didn't. People were not like, okay, everybody, I've got an announcement to make. Everybody that tithed, I've got a $100 bill here, and I'm gonna drop it in the pot. I'm gonna drop it in the pot. I just want everybody to see that this is what's going on with equality. Yeah, people literally standing up and saying, I just want everybody to know. And even in film, but they're bandstanding the idea of equality. So that's not very seamless. And so to me, it like seems like that some of the people that are making Star Wars. Especially with The Last Jedi, it's like, do they really believe what they wrote? Do they really feel that way? Is that really what's in their character? Because when it comes out seamless, when it comes out natural, because as I said again, when I was a kid, it was very natural that these barriers did not exist. Oh, and if you're on YouTube right now, so pause this and go search for this thing called Room 222. This is a series that started, I think, in 1969, and it features an African American a teacher, and a very seam, you know, a very seamless relationship with students that were white, male or female, none of this nonsense. By the time you get into the 90s, females and their relationship to African American men was really disgusting. It's like, well, they thought that fighting inequality was, I really don't want to, I don't really want to recite that adage, but they thought, well, I'm going to give my body to African American males, and that's how they fought. And it's like, well, I'm so equal. I'm so into equality. I'm so into what's right that I'm just gonna strip down and that's terrible. That's not equality. That's the most racist thing that you could do. The most racist. Even I remember Obama used to talk not used to talk about that, but I believe he had spoken just mentioned about spoke about that once or twice. Probably just once, but. About how that's just absolutely just terrible and racist and stuff. Racism is seamless and love was seamless. And the love that I saw when I was in school, and it was 1981, between an African American athlete and she was pretty white. She was as white as a white sheet. and they were together very seamlessly. Nobody said anything. Nobody had any comments or remarks, and the athletes that were in this city that I was in, they were all of different colors, and they all worked together. They were all friends. They went places together. They partied together. They went on dates, double dates, and dated each other together. It was very seamless. So that was a commentary on what's going on in film in general. Everybody wants to they want to reach out from the screen and tap you on the shoulder just to let you know we're getting ready to tell you how socially just we are. We want you to know that, instead of it just being seamlessly written as if it is a natural, and it is natural. It is natural that all species come together and all that. And that's why I have so many different subspecies of sparrows. That's nature. That's nature. We had European sparrows that came over from Europe. They packed their bags, and then they came and they met the sparrows that were in North America. And that increased the survivability of the gene pool. And that's one of the reasons you see so many sparrows, of birds, you see so many of them now, is that you had all these diverse populations that were living in one area, and that when the world became more connected in terms of shipping and animals and birds and things that followed, then they came together, and then they reinforced the gene pool. And that's the way it is with humans, is that you have all these diverse backgrounds. You should have people of Middle Eastern descent seamlessly falling in love with Native American people, with people from of a Spanish heritage, Germans, Japanese,
Polynesia,
and then their children marrying with Caucasian, and Caucasian getting, it should be very seamless. And that's the future, is the great melting pot. That's what the United States was supposed to be about. You know, they called it you never hear about the melting pot, but have you heard that in school?
Yeah, you talk about
the melting pot?
Yeah, I think I've heard about it in grade school before.
Well, that's what was going on, the idea, but it wasn't quite the melting pot at first that it was supposed to be. It was like, well, if you're, what's a melting pot? Because you're a white Irish person, you're a white German person, you're a white French person, why are you coming together to populate? And it's like, no, that's not what it means. It means the people from completely different races coming together and seamlessly folding in love. And it's just so not seamless nowadays, and not very seamless in science fiction. Though I think, and I love Netflix, but not it's often not very seamless in some of the Netflix programming. In some programs it is. In some programs it's just there. It's just there's no one that's reaching out from the screen to tap you on the shoulder to make you aware right now that this is going to be a scene that deals with the justice of equality. When they say justice and equality should be blind, you should be blind to the changes. Being blind, being equated to accepting of it being naturally right. And if we're truly evolved creatures, which we must not be, because yes, there are so many people, as represented by Republican and whatever counterpart of that exists in other countries around the world, fighting against the idea of people coming together. What will happen in Rise of the Skywalker? I'm kind of doubtful, because it seemed like J.J. Abrams jumped off really fast. You know, they finished the movie, and I don't know if he's jumped off completely, but I do think it's kind of cool. He obviously is extraordinary. You know, I will see anything he makes, anything he writes. He writes a book, I'm going to read it. I just don't remember the name of the last one that he wrote, but he wrote a book with somebody several years ago. You know who Cthulhu is? Yeah. They call it Lovecraftian horror. And that's what happened when he wrote the when he made those films of it escapes me because I'm on Star Wars Star Trek. Yeah, speaking of quality, let's also talk about Star Trek. Yeah, Star Trek was all about that. Without tapping you on the shoulder and letting you know that it was about that. How about instead of what to expect, what do I hope I get out of it? I hope that if they don't resolve it properly, that somebody ignites the ultimate weapon that destroys all of the current sentient life, and then allows the galaxy of Star Wars, you know, a billion years to let other forms of life achieve sentience, and maybe they'll do it better. Okay, thanks for listening. Podcast 1. Over and out. Say over and out, Kaya.
Over and out.